Shrivastava to discuss on the introduction to graph design, design concepts and parapsychology. As we know that graph design needs a lot of creativity and innovation, and it also requires in-depth knowledge in photography, drawing, composition and typography. So we welcome Mr. Abhishek Shrivastava to discuss on the give an introduction and also its applicability in various fields.
So hello everyone, welcome to Vision. This is the reading last presentation for today, and today my topic will be, as Deepa ma'am explained, introduction to graphic design, design concept and a little bit knowledge about color psychology. So as we move on, I would like to start by asking all of you a question. In this image, can anyone tell me which cup has tea and which cup has coffee?
Yes, there's a tea bag, so that must be tea.
That's a coffee mug. It's fairly easy.
Yeah.
Let's make things a bit more complicated.
Yeah.
How about now? You cannot tell because there is no indication which one has tea or coffee. Yes, nothing is written there. Okay, let's make it a simple. It will be simple. How about now? Sure. It's not written there, but still everybody knows that that cup has coffee, that one is tea, because of the symbols that I put there. And now?
That's tea, that's coffee.
Obviously. Green color is tea and coffee color is coffee. And again, identical cups. Because of the background, you can tell which one has tea, which one has coffee. So in all these slides, it wasn't written anywhere which one is tea or which one is coffee, but still you were able to tell which one is tea and which one is coffee because of the colors I put there, because of the symbols, or because of the background I put there. This is what graphic design is all about. We communicate with our user or our viewer, not with words, but with our creativity. And that, I believe, is a better means of communication than words in many cases. Okay, so in today's presentation, we will be talking about these basic principles that we use in graphic design. One by one, I'll be covering all of them, and I'll try to keep my presentation as brief as possible. So first, let's talk about balance. So, like it's written there, balance lends stability and structure to an overall design. To balance the design, we need to make sure that we have to imagine our design, as all the elements that there are in our design, they have a visual weight. We have to imagine that. That weight can vary according to the size of the element or the color of the element. The darker the color is, the more visual weight that element carries. The bigger its size is, the more visual weight that element carries. For example, in this image, you can see that this image is not balanced because there is an element of more visual weight this side and an element of a less visual weight on that side. So this design feels like it's going to fall off on one side. That is one major flaw that we should avoid. So in order to get a balanced design, I'll show you some examples. Balance are of two types. One is symmetrical and one is asymmetrical. So these are the examples of two balanced design. You can see in that design to your left, that is a symmetrically balanced design. You can see two elements in the design, both are placed in and distributed in the equal manner throughout the design and the font in between, so that this design seems balanced. You don't see any sense of imbalance in the whole design. In this design, this is asymmetrically balanced, but it is also balanced. In this design, many elements are there, but still it's created that way that you don't feel that feeling of imbalance throughout the design. So both designs looks good and they are eye-catching. Our next principle is proximity. Now, what proximity does that? In every design, we need to create a relationship between all the elements. Otherwise, whenever we are creating a design, if elements don't seem related, the viewer will lose interest in that design. So So in order to create that relation, we can use similar colors, we can use similar shapes, we can use similar sizes to those elements, or we can put them all in one corner. Many things we can do. That all depends on our creativity. For example, if you see in this design, you are the perfect little arrangement of atoms. That's what the poster is trying to say. And you can see there are only two colors used in the entire design, three colors, sorry. White is the background. The navy blue is the atom structure, and pink is the font color. So they, if design, if I use say yellow color here, this design will look, this font will look absolutely different from the design. It won't look like it's a part of the design. So in order to make that part, make it a part of the design, in order to create that relationship between the elements, we have to take care of this proximity principle. So you can see as these pink atoms and molecules are there, the same color is the font. So that is also one thing that we should take care of when we design. Now, another very important thing, alignment. Alignment is not only important when it comes to designing it, it is important when we are creating Word documents or anything like that. So alignment plays a very pivotal role in creating a seamless visual connection with the design elements. If elements are out of alignment, they will look very random, and they will lose their quality of being neat and being clean throughout the design, and the viewer will lose interest in the design. For example, yeah, these are two banners that I made a while back. Both of these banners, you can see clear difference between bad alignment and good alignment. A good alignment is where you can imagine entire content of a design into an invisible box without even the box being there. In that design, you can see all the alignment is bad. It's not properly arranged. But in this design, you can see that all the elements are properly arranged. These alignments, alignments of the symbols and their fonts, everything is properly right. So it gives you that feeling of order and cleanliness in a design, which is eye-catching and obviously is attractive. Fourth principle is visual hierarchy. Now, while visual hierarchy is when we, suppose if we are making a poster and we need to give importance to elements in order. Like there should be an element which should be of utmost importance, then there is an element which should be of second most importance. So how do you create that? In Word document, we can just either use italic or bold to make it highlight it or make it more important. But in the design, when you have to do the same with symbols, there are some things that you can do to make levels of hierarchy and give the level of importances to those elements. Through an example, I would like to show you. Look at these movie posters. In that leftmost poster, the first thing you see when the poster comes up is the title, Guardians of the Galaxy. So how they put it, that they have given it a construct, they have put the fonts bigger, and they have given it a contrast against a darker background. And the second thing you see is the characters. This movie was the first in its franchise. So the first thing the creators wanted to focus the viewers to draw attention is to the title. So they gave the title the utmost importance. So you can, when you look at the poster, the first thing you see is the title, and then the entire thing. The second poster, of course, the movie title is not IMAX. Movie poster has been, movie title is here, but it's not visible. But this poster is not meant to display movie title. Movie title posters, they created many others. But in this poster, what they are trying to tell their viewers that this movie will be shot in using IMAX cameras, and you will be shown in all the IMAX screens. That is the point of focus in this poster. So they have highlighted that by using a bigger font and using red color against a white and gray background. So whenever you see this poster, the first thing you will see is IMAX. So you will immediately, your subconscious will get an idea that okay, this is about this movie being in IMAX. Then the characters and the picture explains the plot of the movie, like two superheroes going against one another. The third poster is a horror movie poster. So the horror movie creators, what their main goal is to make their audience feel the horror inside their hearts, right? So the utmost importance they have given to the title and the picture behind. I don't know, maybe picture may not be clearly visible to you, but in this picture a child is going into the darkness, and the byline here reads, "It will take what you love most." So whenever the viewer look at the poster, they immediately see the child going into the darkness, and their subconscious will start feeling that horror, that okay, and that is exactly what the byline says, it will take what you love most. So their utmost importance they have given is to the image, then the title, Insidious Chapter 2. So this is how a higher hierarchy is created. Whenever you like to give more importance to something, you give it some kind of highlight using different methods. Okay, so our another principle is repetition. Now, what repetition does is that, suppose you are somebody is designing something, or whenever you see some advertisements of a brand or a company or anything, you are seeing one by one their posters and their banners. So repetition tells us to like create a relation between all of those designs. Like some common factor between should be there in all of the designs, so that all those designs should be relatable to the brand of that company, and it should be easily recognizable to viewers. For example, these are some of the designs that also I created a while back. These are all the advertisements for a dummy airline called Phoenix Airways. So you can see all these standees, posters, diary covers, flyers and banners, they have similar color palette. I have used blue color and other shades of blue for all the designs. So immediately when you focus on any one design, which on the color palette also matches with the logo's color scheme. So whenever you see the design, any design, you will immediately realize, okay, this is the same color palette. So your mind will be able to easily relate it to the brand of the company. Like, okay, this company uses this color palette, so this is more relatable to that company. So all these designs have this repetition of blue color palette, so that they are easily recognizable and easily relatable to the brand of the company. So this is one of the most important things whenever designing something for on a larger scale for a bigger company. Now let's talk about contrast. Contrast is when there is a difference between two opposing design elements, like putting dark against light or putting light against dark. So if you have a dark background, you put something light on it, light colored on it, it will give the light colored thing a contrast. This is also one thing we can use to create a visual hierarchy. Like we have seen in the Guardians of the Galaxy poster previously, there was a dark blue background with a yellow font to give it a contrast, and that helped in giving a contrast, and also with the visual hierarchy. So this is also one thing that the designers should be, they usually take care of it. This is one of the most important things to take care of, so that you can actually give contrast to the object you want to attract the viewer's attention the most. For example, it's kind of a similar poster, "You're a sky full of stars." The entire thing is in contrast because it's against a darker background and against blue color, which I'll explain later why. There are some color schemes which look like predefined color schemes. Like for example, yellow will look good with blue and violet, but it will not look good with some other colors. So they use yellow and blue to give it more contrast against a darker background. So that is how contrast is created. Another very important thing is negative space. Now what negative space is, after you put all the elements in your design, the space that is left, that space is called negative space. Now when using creatively, you can use that negative space, you can also use that negative space to communicate whatever you are trying to show in that design. For example, you can see the Apple logo there, and you can also see this is the element, and this is the black part is the negative space where there is nothing. But the creator has used the negative space in such a manner that you can see the face of Steve Jobs in the logo. So that is a creative design, that is eye-catchy, everyone likes it because it's a very good use of negative space. Similarly, the Batman logo. You can see the dark background, a yellow element on it, and then an absence of a black area, absence of yellow area. So that absence of yellow area is actually the logo. When you look at it, you will feel like it's a bat symbol. Though many people don't recognize it because they only see the yellow area, so they see some other different shape. Many people don't recognize it. So they change the logo, and now that logo is simply black. But both of these are very creative uses of negative space. Not every design have to be utilizing negative space, but if you can, it would be a bonus for your good looking design. Now, typography. As it is written, as Paola Scher has said, words have meaning, type has a spirit. If you write something in a simple way, you can easily convey what you're trying to say. But if you can play with words a little bit, you can make them into some shapes, or you can use them in a more creative way, then you'll be able to convey that message in a more attractive manner, in a more recognizable and eye-catching manner. So that art is called typography. Now many designers, they have expertise in different fields. Some of them chooses typography. They practice typography, and they like to earn their expertise in that branch. So how it works is that, for example, you can see the two images here. Now he could have easily written education is the most powerful weapon which you can use to change the world. But he morphed the entire sentence into the shape of a UMP-9 assault rifle. So that makes it more catchy and more attractive. Obviously, if someone is seeing a simply written sentence and this design, they'll obviously go for this design, and that will put a smile on their face. Because that is obviously good. That is a good example of typography. Another good example, melt like an ice cream. Where they have used melt like an ice cream, the entire sentence, into the shape of the cream that you put on a cone. So these are also good examples of typography. So expert designers who are expert at typography, they can use it in a very creative manner, and they can create very good designs with that, but it requires a lot of practice. And the most important thing that I think is color in any design. Even if you're looking at a black and white design, you put color in it, its beauty will quadruple. And color is also good means to communicate what you're saying. So like in the previous design when I showed you the coffee cups, I just by using the colors, you were able to tell that which one has coffee and which one has tea. And when the cups were identical, you were not able to tell. But to understand how to use color, there is another thing that we should learn. It's color psychology. Now, if any of you are from psychology background, you may or may not have read about color psychology. But color psychology is a branch of psychology which deals with the fact that human brain, human subconsciousness, it reacts and sets different reacts differently to different colors. It automatically sets different moods to some level in our minds, looking at different colors without us knowing. So this is the color wheel. This wheel has all the colors that are visible to human eye. All the colors from violet to red. So this is the color wheel, but color wheel has also classification. If we draw a perpendicular line through the center of the wheel, we'll see the colors that we see on the right side, they are called warm colors. From here to here, they are warm colors because these colors tend to give a warm feeling of warmth to our subconsciousness. And similarly, the colors on the left side, they are called cool colors. Because these colors, they give a feeling of coolness and relaxation to our minds. Now, I'm not saying that if you are very tense, just look at blue color and you feel good. That's not how it works. But it works in our subconscious. So this is the color wheel. Now let me explain confidence. For example, the happiness emoji. You can see always most of emojis are yellow, but also most of emojis are happy. So you can see it's yellow, there's yellow color in it, they have used yellow color. And the McDonald's logo. Their byline literally says they have a happy meal. So they have used yellow. There's another reason why they have used yellow and the combination of yellow and red, because when you mix up yellow and red, it gives you the color orange. And orange color is the one that induces hunger. In your mind, it gives you a feeling that you are hungry. So you can see most of the restaurants and their logos, you can see orange, yellow or red color will always be there. So now as we are talking about orange, it is energetic, exciting, it takes the friendliness from yellow and excitement from red, and it induces hunger. It gives a feeling of adventurous and motivation and enthusiasm. Like I said, another restaurant logo using orange color in their logo. These are all marketing strategies they use to make sure that their products sells good, their sale value is good. And Nick, this is short for Nickelodeon, which is a TV channel for kids. So they have used the orange color because kids need those things like energetic, exciting, adventurous, motivation and enthusiasm. So they have used this color because it's giving all those feeling to their kids. So this is the examples of orange color. Now green color. Green color, it's obvious, it's color of nature. You can see, even if you look out the window, you will see trees, green, everything around us related to nature is green. It also brings balance and harmony in the design. If you have used green, it will bring balance and harmony. You will feel good. It gives you a feeling of growth in experience and positive energy. For example, there's another logo, Animal Planet. Everyone knows what Animal Planet. It's a TV channel about nature, about animals. So they have used entirely green and a little bit of typography to make it look like it is connected to nature. And the color of blue. Blue is universally considered as the color of trust. It induces the feeling of safety, reliability, and calmness. The SBI logo. If you cannot trust them, you will not give their money in their account, right? So for that reason, they have used this logo, blue color in their logo. So that the first impression that when anyone sees that logo, it will be like of trust and safety. Ford, for example. Ford are known for, from previous some years, Ford's cars have won the number one award for safety. They have airbags, they have traction control, they have everything. So they have also used this blue logo because from the beginning, they are utmost concerned about their products, their cars' safety. Then separate things they can give, but their goal is to draw the attention of their viewer towards their quality that they provide safety. Hence the blue color. And finally, purple color. Color of royalty and wealth, because kings and queens, even as we see in the TV series they used to wear purple clothes. So it is long associated with royalty and wealth. It also gives power, as it is a color of kings and queens, royalty, so it also gives automatically gives you a feeling of power and stability. And if you want to communicate something related to magic or something mysterious, you can also use purple color, which is a good substitute for any other color. For example, the Hallmark logo. The Hallmark logo is like a universal logo, which is used to, like we have that ISI logo, right? Same thing, the Hallmark logo, it's put on the purest of gold and platinum rings and their jewelries to certify its purity. So that's why they are used. Can you see the purple color in the logo?
Yeah.
So that's why it is purple, symbol of royalty. So as we are nearing the end of our presentation, there's one more thing I'd like to talk about. This is how the graphic designers use colors to their advantage. And the marketing managers, they make sure that their product sells good. They don't lose their customer, they gain customers by using little things like this. And they do actually, because it actually works. It's not just for designing purpose. For example, if you see some advertisement, if it's the dull advertisement and you are seeing the product for the first time, you will immediately lose interest in it. But if it's a good advertisement, you can see all the good colors that they want you to see. If they are carefully research and create an advertisement, you will immediately, your subconscious, you will develop an interest towards the product, and you will say, okay, let's try it. That happens. That actually happens. Okay, so lighter and darker tones. Now, tone sets an overall environment for the design. Whatever design it is, you can set it according to a lighter and darker tone. For example, take this presentation. I have taken a darker background against a lighter one. So my overall tone is a bit darker. But in these designs, these tones doesn't matter much. But where these tones matter is in the field of filmmaking. In the field of filmmaking, these tones matter. Because whatever your movie is about, you have to be sure that whatever you are trying to convey, first the viewer is feeling that feeling. Like if you are making a movie about some tragedy, so it should have a darker tone, so that throughout the movie, the audience will feel that darkness inside them, and they will be able to relate to that movie more clearly. I will show you some example. Another example of a logo only, but in form of a animated short movies. So these are two, nowadays these are two rival companies. These Marvel and DC, they are comic publishing companies. They are both their superhero comics. So they are like polar opposite of each other, where Marvel's storytelling style is a bit lighter, DC's storytelling style, it's a bit darker. That is more kid friendly and comedic in nature. This is more serious and realistic. For example, I'll show you, they have created an animated intro for their logos. You can, I'll show you and you'll be able to differentiate. Sound is not there. But this is the intro of Marvel logo. Throughout the clip, you can see use of many bright colors, many brighter themes, and use of the sound is not there, otherwise the music is also quite inspiring. So you saw that. Now let's take a look at the DC.
Okay, so that was it.
question to it, but then I just have a point to add. Like you said, these big booming companies right now are bending the rules. There are other reasons as to why they are bending the rules. That is the other factors. For example, when an advertisement comes, previously there was no music or there was no logo song or logo music to it. But ICICI Prudential, when it came up with a song. So the color also enhanced and the music also started reminding us of the bank. So these days now graphical and color is not the only component which the advertising companies use to promote their companies. For example, when I was working in a school, so logos were very important. Residency school especially has one particular kind of logo and we had to design a logo for our school. So what we did was, instead of using these usual book, eagle, all of these which symbolizes school as a graphical part or in the pamphlets, we started introducing a song or a tune for the school in itself. So instead of distributing pamphlets, we started advertising it on the TVs with the tone. So now the tune comes, meaning it dedicates to this particular school.
Yeah.
So that's probably one of the reasons.
Yeah, I also agree with the point. I mean, as the technology advances, there are always new means of communication or advertisement will be coming, even in the coming years. These things, colors and all that I just showed you, they are not the only thing that I use. All other things also matter. Like for example, I showed you the intro of the logo. They had sound also, but the sound is not playing in there. But that makes it even more catchy, and you will be attracted to it. So yeah, even in nowadays in graphic designing, they are demanding that you should not just have the knowledge of these designing software. You should also have the knowledge of filmmaking softwares and how you can add sound to it. So yeah, they are also considering all these changes. So well, as the technology advances, means also change. These are just like tip of the iceberg, you can say. Okay, thank you.
Abhishek, I just want to know that you use like 3D techniques, also 2D techniques, right? That is
for this presentation.
Yeah, like the graphic design space, we need to use 3D and 2D, right? Is there any particular reason or to like specifically use it for specific things?
Well, I have used 2D animation. I know a little bit of that. But it's just like in previous days, we did not have 3D animation. We only had 2D animation. So we made use of what we had. After 3D animation came, it's obviously more attractive and eye-catching than 2D animation because you can see the characters or whatever or the design or whatever the advertisement is in 3D. So yeah, as the design trends change, 3D, now 4D is coming. So when everyone has access to 4D, they'll add a software to that too, that you can design in 4D, and then designers will have to learn that software also. Because as the design trends change, 2D, 3D, 4D, you have to keep updating yourself in order to stay with the flow. So right now it's mostly 3D animation in the advertising industry or movie industry, but now 4D is also slowly coming. So I think in some coming years it will change to that also, and advertisement and everything, they will also demand that you should have the knowledge to create a 4D film. So as the trends change, after skills of designers also change.
I just got reminded about one logo, like Sony Bio, like you are remember, right?
Bio.
Bio. Yeah. Yeah. So that simple logo, like it actually signifies analog to digital. Like that dot actually represents sampling. So like, so what you said is exactly right. That creativity plays a major role.
Yeah.
So it's amazing.
Like, I didn't know. I'll tell you, I didn't know that what you tell that logo symbolizes that.
This represents the analog and that 1-0 by
now.
And that dot represents sampling.
Okay. Yeah. It's very eye-catching.
Yeah, yeah. The way they thought about it.
Mm. Like, I didn't know that. I never looked at that logo.
Okay. So
it's good. I mean, every logo has some meaning.
See, this is a very issue, the example of how the logo in itself does not, right? I'm sure if they did not come out and say that it is digital analog, most people would not even recognize it.
Yeah,
And in some sense would not impress the target audience also.
Yeah.
It's that it's true. If they themselves sort of in through other means promote that, oh, this is analog to digital, that along with this sort of then creates an impression that, oh, this company is actually very innovative. See, even the simple is so.
Yeah, that's true.
It's simple along with so many other.
Right, not many people get the meaning of logos. I mean, even the Apple logo, you will find many people that don't like it. They say, even the designers, they say that it could be different. But see, the majority of people like that. So, see, everyone has a different wiring in their minds. Okay. So, you cannot create a design which everyone will. So, that's why they do the research and they go for the majority of quotes. Where most of the people is getting the design and most of the people is liking a design, they go for the design. That's how it works.
That's like the scariest part of making a design. We can only get it when the entire product is a flaw.
Yeah, that's why they do make research. For example, there's something also happens like many original color. For example, take yellow color. Now, yellow color is the color of happiness. Okay. But if you use too much yellow color with all the wrong combination, it actually induces fear. Yeah. So the balance is also very important. If you use too much yellow instead of happiness, it will create fear.
One more doubt, like the fourth thing you told, right? I didn't understand what the fourth dimension like that.
Actually, I also don't know, but they have created some theaters out there which shows movie in 4D. I have not seen, but they might be using some platform.
There, I think
we
can feel also like water sprinkling on you.
Yeah,
something like that. Your own 5D movies, right? 4D movies. There
is some water. The seat shakes and
all. You also move like the car.
Yes, and air.
Okay.
There are small 10-minute movies. I don't know, sometimes in mall periods.
Yeah.
I have seen some movies. And too much shaking also.
Oh, that's nice.
Right to the head.
What's happening?
Too much technology is now coming nowadays. Now they are developing a hologram technology. Where you don't need a screen to project your aura. You can project it out thin. That also should come out in like 4 or 5 years.
Yeah, and one more thing, like virtual reality is also like kind of like you are into some other world. Like you wear that.
Yeah, virtual reality. What they do is that they have that VR headsets, right? I mean, that's a simple example. There are other ways also. You can wear that VR headsets and then you won't feel the distance between your eyes and the screen. You will feel like, okay, it's around.
You are there.
Yeah. That's what you get.
Recall,
right? Which
movie?
Recall.
Total recall.
Yeah.
He starts with wearing this and then
gets
lost in that.
Right? Yeah. Movies actually, many movies give actually very good examples of what is to come in future technology. For example, you said Total Recall. That movie was made like back in 90s, I think.
Yeah.
Back then, virtual reality was not a concept. Mm-hmm. But now it is a concept.
Yeah.
So they made a movie on it then.
At that time.
So, Terminator you can take for example, Terminator series, time travel and all they were talking about. So, movies are also a very good example. Like, actually many people who create these technologies, they also get inspired by things. Like for example, someone got inspired by Star Wars, so he created some similar technology. You can find videos on YouTube of many innovative people who innovate something on their own. Inspired from a movie, and you will see, okay, this thing has a scope that in future it might become usable by others.
How do you safeguard yourself against the psychological impact of these designs and go beyond the designs to understand the malicious intentions of people who are using these designs to sell their products?
Well, I am a beginner, so I stick with the guidelines that I just talked about. But still, I have made some designs, I prefer to ask at least 20 people, how is it looking, what change would you like to suggest. Even when I make a poster, I post in a group. Before that, I ask my family members and what, is it looking catchy? Is it?
Prevent the force of advertising, right, from buying or... remind yourself, you know, don't buy.
Well, sir, look, all the companies, they are trying their best.
Not
me,
my daughter.
That's it, you mean all of us. That's why you know that in Amazon, Amazon or many of these online portals, they have the save, right? You don't have to buy, you just save. They know that save is just postponing it, one day you will buy it. You know there's a save option,
yeah,
right?
Yeah,
you just save it, you don't have to buy, just save. But then, basically I don't think you can escape from the clutches of advertising.
Yeah,
I personally believe it.
It's very rare, because all these companies, they are trying their best to sell their product. So they are using all the psychology.
So the only possibility is believe that you have pure consciousness. None of these objects which are being What's that? You said so. So that's the only option. You let them buy it. Because the whole idea is to say without that product you have nothing, right?
Yeah.
That is what it's basically.
Like within self, just say for example, like when you're watching the movie, that screen, you know, it represents screen as the reality.
Mm-hmm.
What is projected as, without the screen, nothing is there.
Yeah. So in effect, it transfers to these serials, right? The soaps which you see. So you see those soaps as the reality. So you sometimes try to imitate them, right? Our children, teenagers, and even adults are influenced by the soaps. Your ideality is built on the source, right? So what I was thinking, this is a question to myself, maybe others also. You know, in spite of we having at least some knowledge about colors and all those, most of us are poor designers. Now, designers must even in a text, right? Even when you write in a Word file, you will see how badly we write. Look at the sentences sometimes we write. One sentence is one paragraph. And one sentence is supposed to be one sentence, not one paragraph, right? So the whole goal of design, which is easy communication, easy access, communicating the message, which also applies to the textual medium as well. But I don't know how, that's why I feel clarity is so important, even in textual communication or verbal communication as well. So sometimes we think a lot of stuff we put together that conveys the message, and design also sometimes it happens. You put a lot of design elements and you think that is, you know. So sometimes brevity is so important for clarity, and just like in design sometimes, I mean that's one way of looking at it. Sometimes minimalism says a lot. That's just a comment.
Yeah, they are actually a category of posters is called minimalistic posters.
Yeah.
They use very minimal design to convey a big message. Like there was once poster that I saw, it was about Mahendra Singh Dhoni. Mahendra Singh Dhoni, captain, previous captain of the Indian team. So it was a blue colored poster, it was looking Dhoni in black color.
Mm-hmm.
And the O letter of the Dhoni, it was white color, and there's a degree Celsius sign over it. So Dhoni degree Celsius. Right. So it was, what he's saying is that Dhoni is Captain Cool. Yeah. They have named him Captain Cool. So yeah, so he made it that way, that Dhoni, the O is 0 degrees Celsius.
I feel a good designer or a good advertising person who advertises should be extremely compassionate, and the empathy level will have to be very high, because you have to always think of another person, right? Or what will another person will understand? What will the other person understand? Right? Sometimes I think, because most of the time we communicate to ourselves, right? Which more, and we don't understand also. So I feel that, you know, a good communicator, whether it's design, verbal or text, has to also increase the amount of empathy in standing in the other person's shoe. Then only you know what the other person would feel or like or learn, just in case. So now we have to answer, what is our favorite color?
Don't worry, your favorite color doesn't say anything about your personality. So don't think if you choose
you have everything in it.
are an artist, right? You do not ask any questions.
Actually, I was just connecting it with aesthetics only, like with the previous presentation also. When he was talking about the minimalistic thing, like how we connected with what are the elements that are necessary. So even when you talk about the like Anandavardhana or the Gwenny theory also, there also comes about the suggestion. So that is what we saw in the, like all the elements like the SBI logo or something. We feel like we can also draw it. But it is a real artist who finds that you can represent it in a minimalistic way. Even if a child represents it also, it's not that easy for an artist to look it from that perspective and to come into it.
So for example, you know, you can write a draw built in, it's a State Bank of India.
Yeah.
Well, that's very easy, right? Put a photograph. Why give this logo of SBI, right?
Yeah.
So maybe the whole power of suggestiveness is that it gets into your, the gross is not so impactful. Subtle and suggestive is much more impactful and it stays in your memory. It influences you more, right? So not saying everything, but showing away a tip of it and then having the other person think about it and conceive it.
You were talking about that negative space, like, so even in Escher's paintings, if you have heard of Escher, famous painter, so he has this painting called Figure and Ground, in which both figure and ground have meaning. And this is like so many years old. So I was reminded of that when you talk about that negative space.
Yeah, many artists use, even painters or artists, they use negative space, very creative. You get, like you may have seen many images, like there's a portrait of the person, you see it from some other angle or some other perspective, you see some guy playing a trumpet or something. So many examples of use of negative space, or like and famous paintings also, they use the negative stress and creativity. It's a very good thing to use, if you know how to use it.
So apparently here there are artists, she is an artist, right? You draw. You paint? You paint?
Post, basically calligraphy, lettering. And sometimes we make things to apply.
Portraits. Portraits. She is an artist. It's amazing sometimes how the silhouettes give you a more sense of reality or the actual real than the real, right?
Yeah.
For example, the apple in the,
yeah,
the logo which you just showed. Sometimes silhouettes are so, so the virtual sometimes is much more powerful than the real. When you see the virtual, you think about the real, because you see the real all the time, you take it for granted. You have to see the virtual to know the power of real.
That might be the reason people put filters in their photographs. Because it's a real photograph,
right,
and they put filters and they like it virtual. Because it's more
granted.
I was also reminded of Karata's list of colors for each of the moves.
He gives a list of colors.
He gives a list for each mode.
Would you like to say that? Do you remember? Raga is red para, right?
Shingara is red.
Oh, Shingara is red, okay.
Hasya is yellow. Karuna is black.
Really?
Yeah, Shingara is yellow actually. Shingara is yellow, Karuna is black. Raudra,
yes.
Anger is red.
Right.
Shanta is white.
Yeah, it will be nice to look at it. I don't know, he'll give you colors, literally, right?
Even for the mural artists, like mural paintings in Kerala, they also represent the rasas and the color of the space.
So they follow this, right? Very interesting.
So, what is making this logo, actually I worked on many different designs also before, and I talked with ma'am. So ma'am said that it would be good if we make a logo like all of you are familiar with the movie James Cameron's movie Avatar, which came I think, I don't know which year. And that is a tree of souls. And its concept is that its roots are connected to everything on the planet. So ma'am said that a logo should be like that if you can make it like a tree which is connected to everything in you. So first I know tree was easy. I made a tree. But then I thought that how should I make it look like it is connected to everything in the world, and how do you symbolize everything? So I just put it in pretty simple, in the root. It's like everything. And the sun is in the background. Sun is usually, like I said, it's like a ray of hope kind of thing. So I thought, and the colors were also matching. So I thought putting the sun in the background was also good, but the tree is connected to infinity. So that was my primary inspiration for the logo. I made different colors also. Like I used blue leaves, then I used pink leaves, some gradient, other things, and finally this was the one that we finalized.
Insightful introduction and also for the